What can we do to protect ourselves from robot automation?
The CEO explained that machines will replace traditional labor.
This is all about artificial intelligence and how much faster it can process.
Human labor is never going to be cheaper as we get more advanced, and we're just going to have to adjust to that and deal with the results.
The rise of robots has led to some pretty scary warnings about the future of work.
The robots will be able to do everything better than us.
Apps, smart screens, robots, they're probably going to wipe out a billion jobs. And then what are we going to do?
Over another five-year period, we're going to wipe out millions of jobs in the United States and, you know, tens of millions of jobs in the developing world.
This is a humanoid robot, which means it looks, it talks, and it even acts, well, like a human. So does that mean it could take a human's job like mine?
You better believe it.
They are coming to take your job, and nobody's doing anything about it.
The robots are coming. I have to thank my husband for the sound effects. Okay, let's take a look at the evidence. In 2016, McCann Japan announced they created the world's first AI creative director, and it had made a TV ad, the world's first TV ad to be made by a robot. And we, as an industry, got so excited. What would it do? What would it be capable of? Is this the future of advertising? And then, wait, will it be more creative than us? Will it replace us? Is this the future of advertising? And then we saw the ad it made. I think we can all feel safe, but I'll continue. Agency Spy said, it seems safe to say our robot overlords won't be taking over the ad industry anytime soon. Even McCann, the agency that built the robot, said, honestly, it was a major blow. 2 years later, and the industry press got us all excited once again, and it seems forgets all about McCann's AI creative director and the ad it made, and announces that another ad is actually the first to be made by a robot. And Campaign reinforced the fact that a robot made an ad, saying, this is the Lexus ad that no human created. Let's watch it. Looks pretty good, doesn't it? Because a robot made it, right? Tech Radar reported, the storyline itself, along with the script, was concocted using AI in a collaboration between technical partner Visual Voice, IBM, and creative agency, The And Partnership. So it was made by a load of people, too. But the industry press continued to praise the work with plenty of commentary on how beautifully shot the ad was. Well, it would be. It was filmed by Kevin MacDonald, who's an Oscar-winning filmmaker. As for the story, the writing, Adweek said, while shot beautifully and compellingly by MacDonald, the spot script with disjointed ideas form a storyline that's less of a narrative than a series of checked boxes. In summary, Adweek said, in terms of copywriting and overall creative, it's not a stellar ad. But that didn't stop Burger King giving a robot a go. Last year, they tweeted, we forced a bot to watch 1,000 hours of Burger King commercials, then asked it to write a few of its own. Here's the first one. Let's take a look. It opens at the Burger King Food Hotel. Two friends eat Whoppers. They are happy. They are two. They live forever. Friend one, I love Whopper taste. Friend two, I want to grow up to be Whopper. Friend one, I wish I was Whopper instead of a doctor. Burger King watched the friends. He is creepy, but wears the head crown, so it is fine. Friend one, friend two, it is the burlap king. Friend two, I have now grown up. Friend one, cry, I'm still doctor. We see the Whopper and money numbers. Don't show creep king. Burger King logo appears. We didn't see the other ads that the Burger King robot wrote. And we haven't seen any other brands using robots to make their ads since. Why? Because robots can't write ads. Robots can't write copy. But why can't robots write copy? McCann, Lexus, and Burger King all programmed their robots with the data they'd need to create a story. So what went wrong? Well, to tell a story, an interesting and inspiring story, we need more than data. Because an effective story, a story that compels consumers to feel something, and even more importantly, do something, like buy our products, relies on something far bigger and far more important than data. Think about it. When we tell a story, when we write copy, it comes from our mind, body, and soul. I Googled, how do I make a robot? And here's what I found. To make a robot, I need all of this. One microcontroller, two continuous rotation servos, two wheels that fit the servos, one caster roller, one small solderless breadboard, one distance sensor, one mini push button switch, one resistor, one cable, one set of breakaway headers, a battery holder with a 9-volt DC power jack, one pack of jumper wires or 22-gauge hook-up wire. No mind, no body, and no soul. No heart, no memories, no life experiences or nostalgia either. And that's what's missing. That's why robots can't write copy that will engage us humans. We're programming robots with data, but as author and journalist Stephen Poole says, writing is not data. It is a means of expression, and a computer program has nothing to express. Stephen continues, until robots have rich inner lives and understand the world around us, they won't be able to tell their own stories. So that's it. That's what's missing from a robot's capabilities, all the things that make us us. All the things that help us relate to and connect with our consumers. Shared cultures, experiences, memories, references, the tools we need to tell stories. Remember this from Mad Men?
This is Joe Harriman and Lynn Taylor. No Eastmans today, unfortunately. They're all back in the lab.
It's a wonderful facility, but they don't take vacations.
What do they show? Slides of them working?
So, have you figured out a way to work the wheel into it?
We know it's hard because wheels aren't really seen as exciting technology, even though they are the original.
Well, technology is a glittering lure, but there's the rare occasion when the public can be engaged on a level beyond flash if they have a sentimental bond with the product. My first job, I was in-house at a fur company with this old pro copywriter, Greek, named Teddy. And Teddy told me the most important idea in advertising is new. It creates an itch. You simply put your product in there as a kind of calamine lotion. But he also talked about a deeper bond with the product. Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent. Sweetheart. Teddy told me that in Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart, far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. Goes backwards and forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. It lets us travel the way a child travels. Around and around, and back home again. To a place where we know we are loved.
Good luck at your next meeting.
So that's how we create effective communications with our consumers, by using personal experiences and telling stories filled with emotion. It's emotion that helps us appeal to our consumers' hearts and minds. Emotion is what gets our consumers to believe in us, trust us, and most importantly, buy from us. As Paul Thagard says, human emotions depend on our physiology, what we're made of. Because robots are made of metal and plastic, it is highly unlikely that they will ever have the kinds of inputs from bodies that help to determine the experiences that people have. On the theory that emotions are physiological perceptions, robots will probably never have human emotions because they will never have human bodies. Which means robots will never experience the things we experience, robots will never know what it's like to feel something, robots will never know what it's like to have loved and have lost, so robots will never be able to write copy that moves humans like this multi-award-winning ad by AIS in London that went out in 2014. It reads, "I wish my son had cancer. Harrison, my six-year-old, has Duchenne muscular dystrophy. He's one of 2,500 sufferers in the UK who'll die from it, most before they're 20. Unlike cancer, there's no cure and no treatment, and because you've never heard of it, very little funding either. I wish my son had cancer. Harrison's dad, Alex, worked closely with the agency and the charity to write an ad that would shock people into taking notice and acting. A story like this can only really be effective if it's come straight from a real-life experience and straight from the heart. It was covered heavily, not just in industry press, but in national news, and most importantly, the charity received an increase in donations because it appealed to the consumer's emotions and provoked a reaction. But us humans don't have to just rely on sadness to tell effective stories that will make an impact. Emotions are so many things. Fear, anger, joy, surprise, delight. We can draw on any of these emotions to instinctively tell stories, show compassion, offer advice, and tell jokes. But robots can't instinctively or otherwise do any of these things, because as Professor Julia Taylor says, anything that is inherently human is always very difficult to translate into a computer. In 2017, Janelle Shane, an optics research scientist, programmed a robot to write jokes. She plugged in over 43,000 jokes using basic joke structures, and here are some of the jokes the robot wrote. What do you get when you cross a dinosaur? They get a lawyer's. Why was six afraid of seven? Because he doesn't have a birthday. Seeing this approach wasn't working, Janelle tried programming the robot to answer common joke questions, but it couldn't answer any. So why did the chicken cross the road? It answered, to screw in a light bulb. How many engineers does it take to change a light bulb? A star, an alligator, and because they are bees. But it's not just great storytelling and telling jokes that makes a good piece of copy. It's great craft, which leads to great writing. Robots can be programmed to write ordinary lines, but they can't be programmed to write extraordinary lines. Because they don't know the techniques that come from learning the craft, and they don't have the popular culture references that help us play into a current trend. They don't have any imagination, and they don't have any of those wake up in the middle of the night, I've got it moments. As Bill Birnbach said, creativity is the last legal unfair advantage, and we can use that advantage against the robots. Because they don't have instinct, human instinct, natural instinct, so they could never be silly, have fun, and write lines like this, inspired by Shania Twain.
Man, I feel like a woman.
Or this, inspired by John Bon Jovi. They could never get smart. I'm so glad Faris is in the front row. they could never get smart and play with sentence structure like this. And they could never think of the little things that make a big difference, like this line on the bottom of an innocent smoothie bottle. These are things that make our consumers smile. Sorry, can everyone see that? And make them take notice. They make our consumers nod knowingly, or even better, they make consumers like us as brands. And when consumers like us as brands, they believe us and trust us and spend money with us. So the only formula that's ever going to work is not business to business or business to consumer. The only thing that's going to work is human to human, or as I prefer to say, person to person or people to people. Until robots take over our planet, we're always talking to people. But just to double check on my job security as a copywriter, I put it to the test on the BBC World News site. I don't know if any of you have done this. I put in, I am a copywriter, but it didn't even know what a copywriter was. So I tried entering creative. And I guess all of our jobs in advertising are so blurred these days that we fit into a grouping of advertising, accounts manager, or creative director. So we're all just interchangeable to robots, which gives an insight into what the outcome of this highly intelligent test will be. Here we go. Likelihood of automation? It's not very likely. So ladies and gentlemen, the robots aren't coming because robots aren't copywriters. But there is another threat to our relationship with our consumers. It's our consumers. Because our consumers are copywriters, and words are everywhere. Never before have words been used to say so much about so much. Everyone everywhere is using words to share what they think, what they believe, and what they want. Check this out. These are the numbers of users on the biggest social media platforms in 2017. And forget a picture is worth 1,000 words, social posts that rely on pictures actually perform better with words. Over on Instagram, the platform for sharing pictures, posts with just one hashtag, words, get 12.6% more engagement than those without. And 2 years ago, Twitter increased their character limit so we could share even more words. Now there are 500 million tweets a day. That is a lot of words being shared all day, every day, all around the world. 83% of the world's leaders are on Twitter, although obviously we'd prefer it if some of them weren't. And there are more, loads more places to share words. Consumers are writing reviews and breaking their own news with things like TripAdvisor, IMDb, Medium, and Reddit. The list goes on because the list is long. And they aren't just sharing words online. They aren't just wearing their heart on their sleeve. They're wearing their thoughts and feelings on their chest. In 2017, around 15 million people turned up to protests, marches, vigils, and rallies around the world. And they're not just showing up, they're not just showing up to show they stand for something. They're writing placards and signs to show the millions around them and more watching on TV at home what they're standing for. And their placards and signs are so well written, they get noticed. Journalists write about them and feature them in their publications. There are even guides to how to write a great placard. Because consumers are expressing themselves and they want to get it right. They want their message to get noticed. They're even sourcing and buying their own media space and producing their own entertainment. Now anyone can be a blogger, vlogger, or podcaster. Last year, Apple reported there were 700,000 podcasts in more than 100 languages, making up a total of 29 million episodes. Audible has over 200,000 audiobooks, and the TEDx YouTube channel has over 100,000 videos and over 9 million subscribers, with talks being watched over a billion times worldwide. Our consumers are filling public spaces with their thoughts and feelings, and their beliefs, strong beliefs, polarizing beliefs, and their declarations of love. Out-of-office auto-responses have never been so creative. This guy took his inspiration from Back to the Future. He wrote, "If you're reading this, Doc Brown was unable to make lightning strike the clock tower, and I'm stuck in 1985. I won't be able to respond to emails or voicemails until 9-ish on Monday, or until email is invented, whichever comes first." And when consumers are out of the office, when they travel, they write diaries, postcards, blog posts, and reviews. One traveler wrote a brilliant letter of complaint and sent it to Sir Richard Branson at Virgin. Dear Mr. Branson, I love the Virgin brand, I really do, which is why I continue to use it despite a series of unfortunate incidents over the last few years. This latest incident takes the biscuit. Ironically, by the end of the flight, I would have gladly paid over 1,000 rupees for a single biscuit, following the culinary journey of hell I was subjected to at the hands of your corporation. Look at this, Richard, just look at it. I imagine the same questions are racing through your brilliant mind as were racing through mine on that fateful day. What is this? Why have I been given it? What have I done to deserve this? And which one is the starter and which is the dessert? You don't get to a position like yours, Richard, with anything less than a generous sprinkling of observational power. So I know you will have spotted the tomato next to the two yellow shafts of sponge on the left. Yes, it's next to the sponge shaft without the green paste. That's got to be the clue, hasn't it? No sane person would serve a dessert with a tomato, would they? Well, answer me this, Richard. What sort of animal would serve a dessert with peas in? It's in custard, Richard. Custard! It must be the pudding. Well, you'll be fascinated to hear that it wasn't custard. It was a sour gel with a clear oil on top. Anyway, this is all irrelevant at the moment. I was raised strictly by my parents, and if they knew I'd started dessert before the main course, a sponge shaft would be the least of my worries. So, let's peel back the tinfoil on the main dish and see what's on offer. I'll try and explain how this felt. Imagine being a 12-year-old boy, Richard. Now imagine it's Christmas morning and you're sat there with your final present to open. It's a big one. And you know what it is. It's that stereo you picked out of the catalogue and wrote to Santa about. Only you open the present and it's not in there. It's your hamster, Richard. It's your hamster in the box and it's not breathing. That's how I felt when I peeled back the foil and saw this. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking it's more of that custard. I admit, I thought the same too, but no, it's mustard, Richard. Mustard. More mustard than any man could consume in a month. So that was that, Richard. I didn't eat a bloody thing. My only question is, how can you live like this? I can't imagine what dinner around your house is like. It must be like something out of a nature documentary. As I said at the start, I love your brand. I really do. It's just a shame such a simple thing could bring it crashing to its knees and begging for sustenance. Yours sincerely, Oliver Bill. It's brilliant. It's hailed as the best letter of complaint of all time, and it was written by a consumer, and rumour has it Richard Branson offered the guy a job. So, our consumers have the skills and tools to express themselves whenever they want and wherever they go. When they go shopping, they can create their own personal branding, they can personalise anything and everything. So designers have tapped into this major trend in self-expression and now boldly display their names on their products. What was once a discreet sign of premium quality is now displayed loud and proud for all to see, giving consumers another way to express themselves, to tell the world what or who they're wearing. Just like for years and years, they've been telling the world who they're fans of in sport and music. So whether they're writing or telling or reading stories, consumers are craving stories. They're craving connection and they're craving engagement. And they're getting their hit with words, words they read and words they write for themselves and for each other. And as we've seen, they're really, really good at writing. So good that brands are actually asking their consumers to write for them. This is a wall of fragrance descriptions written by consumers at a Penhaligon's fragrance store in the UK. And they're beautiful. With self-employment, startups, and entrepreneurs on the rise, our consumers are doing their own marketing, they're writing their own ads. So as brands, we aren't just competing with our competitors to get noticed, we're competing with anything and everything that's grabbing our consumers' attention. So we're going to have to be really, 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 really good at our job if we're going to make them stop what they're doing, pay attention to what we have to say, and buy our products. The problem is, we aren't that good. We aren't telling good stories and we aren't making ads that get noticed. And when consumers don't notice us as brands, they stop spending with us. Add global insecurities and the problem grows. As brands, we're desperate to future-proof our business. We're looking at research, we're taking on consultancies, we're reviewing strategies, we're looking for ways to appeal to consumers. But what we're not looking for is the really small change that will make a really big difference. The one thing that can be improved and implemented quickly and easily is our relationship with our consumer. An effective relationship starts with a distinctive brand personality and tone of voice to express it. Because when our brand has a distinctive personality, consumers get to know us, and they work out if they like us, and if they want to buy from us. And they work all that out by looking at the words we use, the way we talk. So let's look at how brands in some of the world's biggest industries do it. The travel and tourism industry is worth over $7 billion, and we'll go into specifics in a moment, but typically, brands in this industry talk rubbish. Oh, I'm really good at the punchline and the clicking. Let's try this again. The beauty and cosmetics industry is worth over $17 billion, and these brands talk even more rubbish. And the car industry is worth $273 billion, but the brands talk total and utter
rubbish.
I'm serious. No one's writing an ad that makes any sense. Let's have a look at travel first. So here we go. Kuoni, find your amazing. I don't need to tell you what I was going to say. You're already laughing. That's not a thing. What are you going on holiday for? To sunbathe, sightsee? I'm going to find my amazing. No one says that. So why are we saying it? What's this one? Join the happiness. Again, no one says that. And look how unhappy they are. And look, we've got the same brand. Rewind your happiness. So first you join the happiness, then you go back and do it again. Finally, in the travel section, it's time for a new kind of holiday experience. For some reason, we all add experience to our copy, like holiday wouldn't have made sense on its own. No one says they're going on a holiday experience. And the same goes for loads of other brands. So we have coffee ads that say, taste a new coffee experience, or in retail, brands say, welcome to a new shopping experience. It's all rubbish. Now, by the way, I only get more excited as it gets worse. Let's look at the beauty of the beauty industry. Okay, first up is Olay Regenerist. Is that what it? Yeah. Take years off your skin's age with Olay Regenerist. That is not possible. It is absolutely not possible. I worked in beauty for 8 years. It's the most creative job I've ever had because you have to make everything up. Nothing does anything. I'm sorry to break it to you. A pot of anti-aging cream is powder and water. There is nothing in there that will turn back time. Only surgery can do that. What's next? Ageless eyes. I love this one. Imagine having the same skin around your eyes as you did when you were a baby. You would look so weird. And a cream just can't claim that it can stop your skin from changing. This one. Oh, yes. The first shampoo with a brain. No way. It's a gel that mixes with water. It washes down the drain. It doesn't have a brain. Now, cars, this is my favorite. I don't know if anyone follows me on Twitter, but I really let it out on these guys. So, because they write just the biggest amount of rubbish. Look at this. Lexus, experience amazing. So we've got another amazing. By the way, adjectives are totally meaningless. We shouldn't rely on them to tell a good story. Like Dave said earlier, if you were in his session, show, don't tell. Don't tell me a joke, make me laugh. And we'd never say, what did you do at the weekend? I experienced amazing. Like, no one would say that. So we shouldn't write it. Audacity drives to excellence. Well, I want a word with the person that had the audacity to write that line. Because unless audacity is a person and excellence is a place they're driving to, it doesn't make any sense. At all. Unboring the future. Unboring the car ads, I say, and unboring isn't even a word. And finally, because sometimes all you need is because, I mean, I've got no idea, I just have to give up. It's no wonder our industry thinks the robots are coming and our consumers are writing their own copy when this is what we're all playing at. And what consumer is going to know what to do after reading any of those ads? So what can we do? How do we get it right? Ladies and gentlemen, I have good news. It's actually really easy to write really well, because as Shirley Polakoff says, copywriting is a direct conversation with the consumer. Copywriting is a conversation. When we talk, we're talking to consumers, people. So we must write how we talk. More importantly, we must write how they talk. None of the corporate jargon and marketing buzzwords we come out with in meetings, consumers see right through all that. No, we must use everyday language. As David Ogilvy said, it seems to me you should use their language, the language they use every day, the language in which they think. And because copywriting is a conversation, we mustn't jump in and interrupt our consumers' day or shout at them. We must write copy that feels like we're inviting them to join a conversation that puts them first and tells them what they want to know in a way they will understand and find interesting. Because remember, our consumers are busy. They're taking the kids to school, going to work, working out, shopping, cleaning the house, walking the dog, feeding the cat, feeding the family, they're making dinner, they're washing up, they've got stuff to do. And we're in their ears on the radio, in their face in print, we're on TV, online, on billboards, hoping they'll notice us and pay attention to us. So we must invite ourselves in. We must be welcome in their home and in their car or on their mobile, on their commute and on their high street. We must talk directly to them. We must be on their side, on the same page, and talk their language. Because when we don't, it feels uncomfortable. Copywriting is a conversation. We must write how we talk. This is the first lesson in copywriting. It's the first thing to remember when we write anything. And it's the one thing we do naturally, which is what makes it so easy. The way we talk is the one thing that makes a great piece of copy. Dave already stole my thunder this morning and played this, but like this ad.
Here's to the crazy ones. The rebels. The troublemakers. Ones who see things differently. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
This is one of the greatest ads of all time for many, many, many reasons, but one of those reasons is the way it talks to the consumer. It talks like them. Unfortunately, great ads like that are rare these days, because for some reason, we take words and make them totally meaningless. Look at this campaign from The Gap. Iconic Gap denim redefined. What does that mean? It doesn't matter, because they like that word and they're running with it, so they've got it in the next one. Iconic Gap cords redefined, and iconic Gap shirts redefined. I don't know what they've redefined about any of those things, because they all look pretty defined to me. But everyone's at it. It's everywhere. Never have there been so many meaningless ads, which means never have we been so unoriginal and boring. Look, we've got it in telecoms. Connectivity redefined. And again, fun redefined. And again, although I don't know what this means, flagship redefined. And then it expands to more than mobiles with a laptop, which is semi-rugged redefined. I don't know what that means either. But look, it's just so multi-purpose because you can use it on something completely different. Cars, you know I love a car ad. Rugged redefined. With another car ad, prestige redefined because it's a bit posh. Power dynamics redefined. It's so flexible, it works for luxury brands too. Luxury performance redefined. And while we're in the luxury market, we'll chuck it in again. Luxury redefined. And again, luxury redefined. And sweet life redefined. And then this one's really special. Royalty redefined. Or is it that special? Because here it is again in the fashion industry. Royalty redefined. So obviously we need a fashion redefined. And ladies, we all know we can't have fashion redefined without jewelry redefined. Or beauty redefined, and beauty redefined, and hair and beauty redefined. But to be beautiful, we all know this, we need our beauty sleep redefined, or just our sleep redefined. And again, sleep redefined. And to redefine your sleep, you need your pillows redefined. And hotels have to get all those beds and pillows for you to redefine your sleep, so there's distribution redefined. And we all need to keep fit, so there's fitness redefined, and fitness redefined. And to keep fit, we need the kit, so there's the run redefined. And we must keep healthy while we're doing all this fitness, so there's smoking redefined. But if we aren't healthy, there's healthcare redefined, and medicine redefined. And if things go really wrong, we've got risk regulation redefined, and business lending redefined. At home, we've got television redefined, and look, experience is back again, and we've got a coffee experience, which is redefined. And a beer, created for legends, so it's a legend redefined. And all this will change your life. So we've got lifestyle redefined, and again, lifestyle redefined. And get this, It's not every day that a city gets redefined. No, it's not. Then we've got friendship redefined and blonde ambition redefined. Does Madonna know? Woman redefined, and you can be in charge too. Look, style, however you define it. But then it gets a bit aggressive. You drive it, you define it. No wonder we're worried about robots coming for our jobs, and no wonder our consumers are writing better than some of us ever could. Ladies and gentlemen, there is work to do. Copywriters, there is plenty of work for us to do. So I leave you with one very big request. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Please, respect copywriting, respect the craft, respect copywriters and respect consumers, because only then will we write anything that makes any sense to them and makes any difference to our business and our industry. Thank you.